Here's an idea. A tagged Instagram is more than just a photo. Hashtag idea Oh, sorry. Though it might be the greatest thing to ever happen to photography, there's tons more going on with Instagram than just artsy photos of people's cats and sandwiches. Instagram has its own communities, celebrities, approval systems, double tap, and of course, its own tagging mechanic. Placed in the caption field of the photo that you're uploading, hashtags organize the snaps snapped by an army of thumb-wielding proto-Cartier-Bressons. And while there are tags on Instagram like there is schnitzel in Germany, there are a good number which stand out, like Uber Schnitzel. We're gonna talk about three common hashtags that say something about Instagram, and also maybe a little something about how we think about modern photography. First, we're gonna talk about Latergram, a hash which is tagged onto photos which were taken in the past. Up until Instagram, or maybe just before, photography was the practice of capturing images for the sole purpose of having them for later. Every Ansel Adams photograph is a Latergram. Heck, every photograph is a Latergram. Hashtag Latergram shows that photos maybe aren't as strictly atemporal as they once were. Now there's this weird feeling that if you post a gram of where you're not and you don't hashtag Latergram, it's like you're lying.
You sit on a throne of lies.
Meaning photos, especially Instagram photos, have become just as much a declaration of the present as a visual memento. It also means that people are taking photos with their phones and then saving them for later. I mean, why not post all the photos of your cousin's quinceañera at once? Well, maybe. If you post too many great photos all in a row, you won't get as many imaginary internet popularity points. Which brings us to tags for likes. One of the central features of hashtags is that they create impromptu communities. They allow people to gather around and track specific topics. Sports events, adorable things, music tastes, you name it. And the more hashtags you include, the more communities you are potentially reaching out to. And the more communities you reach out to, the greater chance you'll get yourself some likes. Heart this. The hope is to play the numbers game. You include a ton of tags, get in a ton of searches, get a ton of likes, a ton of followers, and then blam, you become Insta-famous. Like Tumblr and Twitter and YouTube, Instagram users love making things, but they also love recognition. Tags for likes, Insta-good, and Insta-famous are part of the ever-shifting, shifty shape of fame. For every public platform on the internet, there is another road to global recognition, and Instagram is no different, as long as, of course, your photos look good. Which brings us actually to no filter. Hashtag no filter indicates that the photo's uploader decided not to use what is arguably Instagram's central feature, the application of an old school nostalgic filter. No filter is kind of like saying, nah man, this photo is so good, they don't need no filter. But aside from being a little braggy, in my mind at least, is it also, strictly speaking, not possible? Between an awe-inspiring vista and me commenting, cool photo, bro, are there not filters upon filters upon filters? What about camera lenses, image capturing hardware and software, rendering this and that? And if you want to get crazy, what about your own perception? No filter invokes some sort of trueness or verite, as if to say, no, 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 this is the actual photo. And maybe tries to inch the no filter photo closer to not phone photo snapping, which is itself also a series of filters. Okay, so these tags, why are they important or interesting? Well, besides providing searchable collections of images, though I'm not really sure you'd want to see all of the Latergrams in the same way you'd want to see all of the hashtag Harry Styles's, they also provide a context or commentary. Think about all of the meaning they attach to their photos. Now, this is true of all hashtags on all platforms, but especially neat for Instagram because hashtags are frequently the only textual content on a post. They are the only thing with a literal meaning. Sure, a lot of the time it's hashtag sunset on a picture of a sunset and hashtag swag on whatever swag is. But like our examples, they also can make explicit a meaning which was otherwise only implied or totally external to the picture or didn't even exist until invoked by a hashtag. And tags do this in a way that normal caption text can't. Tags are a bit of what Espen Artseth calls cybertext. Cybertext, quote, posits the intricacies of the medium as an integral part of the literary exchange. This means tags also make Instagram photos different from normal photos. Photograph and tag and comment all become part and parcel. Like, how different would our experience of all of these famous photographs be if we only knew them with tags? All of this stuff adds layers of depth and relationship to what otherwise might just be a photo. How great that depth is and how meaningful it might be, well, that depends heavily on which tags you're looking at. G-P-O-Y. What do you guys think? How much additional meaning is added by tags? And what can we learn from some of your favorite tags? Let us know in the comments. And if you love Idea Channel, you know what to do. Double tap. I might not pixel agree with what you have to say, but I will defend until my pixel death your pixel right to say it. Let's see what you guys had to say about the morality of buying video games. First and foremost, a big thanks to Jake at Vsauce3 for shouting out last week's video, and to all of the Vsauciers in the audience, we're happy to have you guys. Anybody who hasn't seen Jake's video about the cost of Call of Duty in real life, you should watch it. We'll put a link in the description. Caristro says that if you want to escape this moral conundrum, you can do so by just pirating a game. And that makes me wonder whether or not that's sort of files under two rungs don't make a right. A lot of other people also said that you could do it by buying a game secondhand, which, yeah, I mean, that provides a little bit more distance, but then in some way you might still be supporting an industry that supports an industry you don't want to support. I don't know. Yeah, some levels. There's levels to this one. To Jay Fugo and everyone else who recommended Special Ops The Line, actually, I haven't played it, but I have heard that it really responsibly interrogates the moral choices of shooting pixels at other pixels. So it's on my list now. Liam in Color says that this moral conundrum is rendered null and void by the fact that the amount of practical effect you will have by purchasing games is actually very, very small compared to a huge number of other factors, which, yeah, if practical effect is what you're concerned with, then yeah, that might be a way out of this moral problem. To Ying of Darkness, I think the point we were trying to make is that realism contributes to certain kinds of games and not to the quality of games overall. Like, if Minecraft or Starseed Pilgrim or other games were realistic, yeah, they wouldn't be half the games they are. Michael Clark wonders, in modern society with so many moral landmines, is it even possible to not be a hypocrite? Is hypocrisy just a state of being? And I think, yeah, depending upon your belief system, life can get real complicated really fast. Relatedly, Graham Wallace and a bunch of other people point out that paying your taxes could even be a moral choice. And I think this is a little complicated because you could argue that paying your taxes isn't really a choice, but if you really don't like the way your country conducts itself, then, yeah, I mean, you could choose to not pay your taxes, and you certainly wouldn't be alone, you know, you'd be in the sort of civil disobedience, Thoreau-style kind of thing, but, yeah, you might get yourself in some trouble. To Davey the Bro, thank you so much for being with us from day one. That's so awesome. And to anyone else who missed the memo, we got nominated for 2 Webby Awards, which we are doing. You guys are awesome, so we're doing really well. But if you haven't voted yet, you should. We'll put some links in the description. We hope that you want us to win. And also, we recently hit 200,000 subscribers. So let's round of applause for everybody, for you guys. Thank you so much. We're gonna make a video celebrating this thing, but we just wanted to say thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you to everybody for being just the, like, literally the coolest. This week's episode was made with the awesome work of these handsome and talented people. I was also on NPR this weekend, so we'll put a link to that in the description. And this week's tweet of the week comes from DaThings, who, I'm not even gonna describe it. You should just watch it.